The Oxford Q-Step Center, which I'll talk about in a minute, what it entails, is really there for you. So it's not without reason that we start off with a session for students, about students, and a possibility for you to actually ask questions, not only ask questions to people who know something about numbers, but actually to the author of the book that you'll be using. So that's kind of a unique opportunity. So although you haven't perhaps started yet, you might want to already pick his brain. What we're going to do today, I think, is, it's called the Q-Step launch, it's called the Glorious Numbers. So I think we're going to try to celebrate numbers today, and to celebrate data analytics, and to talk a little bit about why it's important to acquire skills of data analytics. And we're going to have some amazing people in a panel that will introduce those thoughts or their experiences with you. But before I do, I wanted to say a couple of things as well. Some of you may recall who I am because we had an induction here last Friday. My name is Catherine de Vries, and with many people who I'll just introduce in a second, I'm part of the Oxford Q-Step Center, and we're going to be responsible for the so-called Part C of prelims. For those people who are not from Oxford, we have a lot of acronyms. So that's the political analysis part, teaching you about how political scientists or social scientists, perhaps in general, go about gathering data, develop a research question, gather data to answer that research question, use certain data analytics, and use programs, statistical software, which we will familiarize you with as well. And that's what we're going to teach you in Hillary terms, so next term, in the context of the Oxford Q-Step Center. But when I introduced that last Friday, I saw a couple of people, maybe being excited because it's the new syllabus and you're guinea pigs, that might be interesting, but also a bit anxious perhaps. A bit anxious because these are new people that are going to teach you, but also anxious because why the hell do I need to learn about numbers? Catherine seems very enthusiastic, but I'm not so sure I am. So why do we learn about data? Well, people are going to talk about that at length today. Well, at length, a couple of interventions and then hopefully Q&A. But I think what's really important is that PPE and History and Politics in Oxford, if you've seen the movie Riot Club recently, gives this impression, or in The Spectator there was an article, that we teach you, and this is going to be recorded, so I'm going to preface this, but we teach you how to bullshit. We teach you how to be kind of polemic, how to use arguments and how to come, to get those across in the best way possible, but not necessarily arbitrating between different scientific views by using data. I think none of us in this room think that's true. I think that the outside world has a particular idea, especially about PPE, which might not be entirely true. But I do think that we haven't done enough in the past to maybe within the politics study to give you the tools to really use numbers and to use data to arbitrate between different views. Should we concentrate political power through, for example, a majoritarian electoral system like we have in the UK? Or should we diversify power or try to disperse it between different actors, for example, via a proportional representation model that's from the country where I was born, the Netherlands? So these kind of questions you could argue your way through, but perhaps sometimes it's useful to get data and to try to see, hey, what happens in the real world and what does the real world tell us? That's reason number one. And I think the second reason is that data analytics doesn't only help you in your studies, but it helps you in your career. And that's the topic of this particular panel. And to use the words by Hal Varian, who's the Google chief economist, he said recently in the Harvard Business Review, the sexy job in the next 10 years will be that of statisticians. People think I'm joking, but who would have guessed that computer engineers would have been the sexy job in the 1990s, in the early 2000s? Statisticians are important because statisticians are those ones that some people even suggest are going to be the new bankers, i.e. they're making a lot of money by developing certain type of models. Not to say that all of you are here to make money, but at least data analytics might also help you, not just in your studies, but outside as well. So before I will introduce the panelists, I also want to take this opportunity and to thank a couple of people, and that's to thank the Department of Politics and International Relations, and especially the administrative staff within that, and I'll do that formally in the drinks later, but also my head of department, Liz Fraser, who's in this room, Eddie Keane, who's the deputy head of department, who have been really important and supportive of this, as well as the previous head of department, Stephen Whitefield, and Paul Martin, the deputy head of department. But also thank the Department of Sociology, in which the QCEP Center is embedded as well. And then lastly, before I introduce the panel, I want to thank a couple of people who are in the front row, and I want you to stand up, although you don't want that. Elias Dinas, who's going to be teaching you in the Oxford QCEP Center. Hi, Elias. Andrea Ruggeri, who sits next to him, who's also going to be teaching you in the Oxford QCEP Center. Andreas Murr. Yeah. Spiros Kosminis. And last but not least, Andy Eggers. Okay, so that's the team you'll be working with. And now I have the amazing opportunity to introduce a couple of people to you. I would ask them to come to the front, if that's possible. That's first Andrew Dilnot. Sir Andrew Dilnot, I'm sorry. British economist and broadcaster, and I actually had now... Prior, I thought I should know what I'm talking about. Online, you can listen to his History of Britain in Numbers, which I found very interesting because I'm an immigrant to this country, so I learned a lot. So he's a broadcaster as well as an economist. He is, I think, the main daytime job is being warden of Nuffield College. He was also the principal of St. Hugh's College before, and he's also the chair of the UK Statistics Authority, so he has something to say about numbers. But interestingly, he is also, he just told me, 36 years ago, he was here. He's a PPE graduate, so he can also tell you a little bit about what you can learn from PPE, and I think it goes the same for history and politics, and what numbers, which are the value from numbers in the rest of your career. The second person who I would like to introduce is Paul Kellstedt, who traveled the longest. He traveled all the way from the United States. He's a professor of political science at Texas A&M. I have read most of his work, and you will read most of his work when you take the paper on political sociology. He works on elections. He works especially on the role of the economy in the vote and attitudes people have about politics. And he's currently at Texas A&M. He was also an academic visitor at Nuffield College, so he knows Oxford well. But I think most importantly for us here in this room, he's the author of the book that you'll be using. So him, together with Guy Ritten, wrote a very important book, I think, or very important book for teaching quantitative methods for political scientists, and that's The Fundamentals of Political Science Research with Cambridge University Press. Thanks very much for making the way all the way from the US. Thanks, Paul. And the third, last but not least, Slava Mikhaylov. Slava joined the Department of, is it Department of Politics? Political science, sorry, at University College London in 2010. I know him very, very well through his work on getting text and transferring that into data, which sounds maybe a bit strange at first, but he does that very well. He uses a lot of fancy computers to do that, and he actually comes up with trying to get meaning from text and tries to test models about speeches or about legislative behavior using so-called big data techniques, i.e. scraping the web and then analyzing that. I'm saying this as if I know something about it, but analyzing that with data analytical techniques. So this is the panelists for now, and what I would like to do is to introduce them, to ask them to come here, give a 10-minute intervention, and then we'll follow that by Q&A, so think very... You know, think about the questions, or maybe write them down if you want to, and then we'll have some time for them to ask, to answer your questions as well. Andrew, do you want to start?
Yeah. Thanks, Catherine. It's lovely. Thank you for reminding me that it's 36 years since I was 18. That makes me feel really great. You have no idea how lovely it is to be 54. Something that I think everybody in the room, apart from me, can look forward to being 54. It's quite something. Numbers are... Numbers are everywhere. Numbers are beautiful. They are crucial. They are easy. I went and spoke to a bunch of school children on Friday evening about all this. One of the points I made to them, I held up a copy of the front page of one of our broadsheet newspapers, the Daily Telegraph from, think 2 years ago, it ran a headline. No, 4 years ago, it was the summer of 2010. The Daily Telegraph ran a headline which said, new figures show public sector pensions will cost each of you £4,000 a year. And we get headlines like that all of the time. It was the main banner headline in the Daily Telegraph that day. And that's an important story. It followed a new piece of work produced by the Office for Budget Responsibility, the independent assessor of what's going on in public finances, which said that public sector pensions were indeed going to cost £9.4 billion. So the Daily Telegraph, the journalist, had taken £9.4 billion, said this in the paragraph, and had divided that £9.4 billion by the 26 million households in the UK. Now that's not a sum that, I mean, I know some of you have done that sum already, you're the intelligent looking ones. Some of the cooler ones haven't yet done the sum. And it's not an easy sum to do just off the top of your head. 9.4 billion, 26 million, they're different orders of magnitude. Well, 9.4 billion divided by 26 million is the same as 9,400 divided by 26. Now 9,400 divided by 26 is a bit like 9,000 divided by 30, and that doesn't feel like 4,000. The Daily Telegraph journalist had got the answer wrong by an order of magnitude, by a multiple of 10. The answer to the question they tried to do was not nearly 4,000, but nearly 400. Public sector pensions cost you £400 each isn't such a good headline and wouldn't have run. Now, the thing I want you all to reflect on is how many letters would have gone to the Daily Telegraph if a front page story on the Daily Telegraph had had an apostrophe in the wrong place? And the answer is lots, because we're all proud of being grammar nerds. Now, I'm a grammar nerd and grammar pedant, and it really irritates me when people put apostrophes in the wrong place. But it's worse when you get the answer to an important question wrong by an order of magnitude, by a multiple of 10. You produce absolute garbage, and we should be at least as intolerant of that kind of nonsense as we are intolerant of people getting the grammar wrong. Now, I'm going to make you do some work. It's after lunch. I don't want you to fall asleep. Some of you will have experienced this before. We're going to have a multiple choice question. And it's going to be a multiple choice question that relates to something very, very important, which is inequality. So you're studying politics, philosophy, history, economics. In all of those areas, inequality and what's been going on to it really, really matters. So this is the question. Imagine that we line up the whole adult population of the United Kingdom by what their household net income is. So we'll have those with the highest net incomes over there and those with the lowest over here. And by household net income, I mean income after you've paid your taxes and after you've received all your social security benefits. And we're going to adjust it for family size, so that's all accounted for. So those with the highest incomes over there, those with the lowest incomes over here. Then we're going to take the person 10% from that wall, so the person at the 90th centile of the income distribution over there. And we're going to divide their household net income by the income of the person at the 10th percentile point. So this is a common way of measuring inequality. It's the 90-10 income range. What is the multiple of the household net income at the 10th percentage point that we find at the 90th percentage point? And I'll give you five options. You can say that it's 4, 6, 8, 10 or 12. So I hope everybody gets the question. How much more income do those people at the 90th percentile have than those at the 10th percentile? Is it 4 times, 6 times, 8 times, 10 times or 12 times? So, and you need to answer. If you don't answer, then you're going to have to come and stand at the front and sing a hymn of my choosing. Okay, so pay attention, or unless we have any choristers here. Doesn't look likely. Who thinks the answer is, we won't allow the people in the very, we'll allow the people in this row to answer, but we won't allow the people in this row to answer because you might think they know the answer. And that might be embarrassing for all kinds of reasons. So who thinks the answer is 8? 14. Who thinks the answer is 6? 1, 2, 3, 4. Who thinks the answer is 10? Who thinks the answer is 4? Who thinks the answer is 12? So I think 3 thought the answer was 4, 4 thought the answer was 6, 14 thought the answer was 8, about 25 thought 10, and about 20 thought 12. And I'll tell you the answer in a little while. Why choose inequality? Well, inequality really, really matters to all of the disciplines that are represented here. Economists are very interested in what's driving inequality. People who are interested in the distribution of income are very interested in what the level of inequality is. People who are studying politics are very interested in what changes in inequality do to voting behaviour and the behaviour of governments. Philosophers are quite interested in what it might mean and what kind of thing it might be, and historians are interested in everything. Let me now get a slide up that shows you. First of all, we'll go with my very favourite slide. Security alert. So this is my very favourite slide. This is a slide that shows you the UK's household income distribution. Sorry, guys. This is in weekly pounds, numbers in millions, people. The stripes are 10 percentage points. So this is the poorest 10%, the next 10%, and this is the top 10%. You can see that the most common income is about here, a bit more than £300 a week. The most common household net income in the UK, equivalized for family structure using two-adult childless couple as the norm, is a bit more than £15,000 a year. The midpoint in the household income distribution, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, is here, is a little bit more than £20,000 a year. Half of the households in the UK have a net income of less than £20,000 a year. The top 10% of the UK household income distribution starts here. That is a little bit more than £40,000 a year. The really sharp amongst you will have realised that you can work out the answer to the question I asked you earlier from this chart, because all you need to do is divide that number by that number, and you can all see that three of you were right. The answer is 4. Now, if it's any comfort, just before I came here, I asked two very, very senior professors in the social sciences. I shan't go any further than that because it would identify them. What the answer to this question was, and one of them said 10 and the other said 12. Not many years ago I asked all the bishops of the Church of England the answer to this question, and they all said 10 or 12. I've asked the heads of all of the civil service departments the answer to this question, they also said 10 or 12. This is the 90-10 income range since the early 1960s. It's now roughly, since this slide was made, it's come down a little bit, which often happens in recessions. How can we even begin to do what social science does if we don't take this kind of quantification seriously? If you want to think about inequality as an economist, a political scientist, a philosopher or a historian, you've got to have access to this kind of data. But you've also not simply got to believe the data. So I've told you what the 90-10 income ratio is. Well, how on earth do I know? That slide that I just showed you before, how on earth, where does that data come from? Is it just beamed down? Do we know it? Comes from a sample. We survey a group of households and they answer the questions. Are they good at answering the questions? Do they tell the truth? And then I told you rather glibly, oh, well, we'll equivalise it. We'll just normalise it for household size. Well, how do you do that? How do you compare the income of a single person with the income of a retired couple or the income of a single parent with 4 children and make it neat so that you can start measuring inequality and compare it over time? How on earth would you even begin to do that? What do you do when quite a lot of people tell you that their income is naught or negative? What kind of statement is it to say that your income is naught or negative? How many of these people up here with very, very high incomes have really got very high incomes? Or how many, because this is a weekly survey, are self-employed people who just happen to get paid all of the income they're going to get paid in for the last 6 months and the next 6 months in that time period? Those kinds of things really, really matter. They're statistical questions. We have to think really hard about these. I asked you how to measure income inequality, and I've measured it using a 90-10 income range. Well, is that a good way of measuring inequality? Why did so many of you get the answer to that question wrong? Well, because there has been a big growth in inequality recently, and much of it has been right up here. How do we weight inequality at one end of the income distribution compared to another? How would you compare 2 years of inequality that have gone up when they've gone up in different parts of the income distribution? Perfectly plausible that we might see income inequality reducing here and rising here. Well, how would you think about what to say about those kinds of things? These are all crucial questions that are fundamentally about engagement with, first of all, data, then in statistical thinking and the application of statistical methods. We can't do the things that we want to do unless we take them seriously. We live in a world at the moment where, by and large, people don't take them as seriously as they ought to, and where, by and large, the political debate, the social scientific debate, carries on as though this kind of data isn't available, as though you can have discussions without knowing about the country in which you live. You can't. You desperately need this data, and you desperately need not to take the data at face value, to think about where it came from, to think about what you might want to do with it, and to think about the underlying intellectual constructs that we relate often too easily to data. So it's not a simple thing to talk about inequality, and I don't know whether there will be stuff on inequality in any of your courses, but it turns out that the measurement and assessment of inequality is an intellectually extraordinarily fascinating subject, full of beautiful, quite formal methods which interact with the reality of the data that we can collect. So love numbers, they are beautiful, powerful things. You'll find that if you take data and its analysis seriously, you will have astonishingly powerful tools in any areas of your work and life. I've now been doing this stuff for 34 years. I got involved at a marvellous institution called the Institute for Fiscal Studies when I was still a student, set alight, this is a sad thing to admit, set alight by an article in a journal called Fiscal Studies called that was analysing the consequences of the reduced rate ban for income tax. And the thing that set me alight was seeing what you could do with a combination of analytical rigour and engagement with data. It's given me so much delight that it's made my hair fall out. It's opened up extraordinary opportunities for me, opportunities to come and work in this great university, opportunities to work with the BBC, which is a fantastic broadcasting organisation, opportunities to work at places like the IFS, to be engaged in public policy, both as a commentator and as somebody engaged in actually forming public policy in some areas. And again, my perception has been that you don't need to be as smart as everybody else if you dedicate yourself to data and its analysis, because there are nothing like enough people doing it so far. You will change all of that. Thank you very much.
They're forcing you to do this. They're making you do this, right? And I know, because I teach classes like this at different universities back in the United States, that if all of you had your druthers and you didn't have to admit it in front of your professors, and you said, like, you know, it's a little secret checkbox, or you could text a little thing at your phone and kind of like look. Do you really want to take this political analysis class, or would you rather have a class on inequality? That sounds really cool. That 90-some-odd percent of you would say, I don't want to take this political analysis class. I don't want to do this. I want to take a class on the substance of politics. That's why I'm a PPE person here at Oxford, because of that. Not because I want to do this statistics, mathy, sciencey stuff. And for those of you who are in the, like, there's probably somewhere a little less than 10% of you that say, no, actually, I really kind of want to take this stuff. Like, there are no antibiotics for that disease. And there's no known cure. If you're one of those people, God bless you, because I am too. So I have a couple of little preliminary things. And then why they're making you take this class, and then why it's actually good for you. because it is good for you. And I think that actually we've already heard a better explanation of why it's good for you and why it's good not only for you, but good for the world. Well, maybe that's a little too grandiose. So just a preliminary thing. Yes, full disclosure. That's my book. It's half my book. And so on behalf of my family, I appreciate the royalties that I get from this. Trust me, I was asked earlier today whether with the royalties from the book I can buy a flat someplace nice. And I said, no. I could maybe rent a flat someplace nice on Airbnb for a long weekend, but that's about it. But in any case, it's been quite satisfying to be a part of this project with my friend and collaborator, Guy Witten, and my little-known fact, my wife's cousin is the one who did the cover for the book, which I like. I think the cover's pretty cool. So why are they making you take this class, this sequence of stuff? And so I think it's a perfectly fair thing for you to say, hey, this education, I'm paying for this education, and if you're forcing me to do anything, whether it's, you know, eat your broccoli, and you could say, as maybe some of you did, for those of you who don't like broccoli, why are you making me eat my broccoli? And there's presumably a good answer. There's vitamins in the broccoli, it's perhaps antioxidants, and maybe in the long run there's this possibility that you'll be less likely to get cancer if you eat the broccoli and stuff. So we're making you eat the statistics. And you say, well, what's in it for me? And it's different from the benefits of the broccoli, I assure you. So, but there are three things that I say are the benefits of learning this combination of research design and the associated statistics that go along with it. The first is to make you a better consumer of information in the media. And we've already heard a fantastic example of this, that where you're able to say, you don't have to take arguments that you hear, for example, in a political campaign or on BBC or wherever. You don't have to take them at face value at all. And people will, and they do all the time, try to pass off ideas to you that imply that something causes something else. For example, that a policy works or that a policy doesn't work. Right? You hear that all the time. Embedded in that is a claim about causality. The policy causes an outcome or doesn't cause an outcome or causes a bad outcome. And you're going to learn, and it's really important to learn, some intellectual habits, and you'll exercise those intellectual habits. You'll work at them to get better at sort of stripping away the rhetoric and beginning to approach problems like a scientist would approach problems and say, well, how would I know whether this policy works or not? What's the best way to think this through? And there are some best practices that you'll learn in these sorts of classes. So perhaps less importantly, but maybe more importantly in the short run, to make you a more competent consumer of information in political science and in other social science classes, and frankly, in other classes that aren't from the humanities. It's not going to make you understand Shakespeare any better, I assure you. I've tried. It doesn't help with understanding Shakespeare. And so you know, but in all of your other classes, there are going to be causal arguments about how things work. Why, in a sociology class, where they deal with things like inequality or suicide or things like that, well, what are the kind of the things that are causing these patterns to change? So it should help you clearly in your other classes. And the last is to give you some real-world skills with actual data analysis packages. And I assure you, you don't have to become a statistics geek in order to have marketable skills in the world. I have several stories of students of mine who've taken classes like this, and my favorite one is this student who got an internship with a political party in Texas to basically do anything they wanted. He's an undergrad and he got an internship, right? So what are your duties going to be? Whatever they tell you to do, right? So the first day on the job, what does he do? What do you think the intern does the first day on the job? They go to Starbucks. That's exactly right. They go to Starbucks with some list of lattes and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, they come back trying not to spill all the coffee and comes in. And there are 15 or so people in the conference room. And this guy is setting down the lattes and passing stuff out and getting sugar and all this garbage. And someone sets down this sheaf of paper and says, so the pollsters gave us some results. And there are these regression models in SPSS and... You know, there's a bunch of lawyers in the room. Smart people, mind you. Smart, very smart people, very ambitious people. They don't know anything about statistics. Anything about statistics. And intern boy says, someone says, like, you know, does anybody know what's going, you know, what to do with this stuff? Intern boy says, I've seen stuff like that before. That was the last coffee he ever got for anybody. And it totally changed totally changed the entire summer that he was doing stuff, and he started crunching numbers. He sends me this charming email. He says, you always say, Professor Kellstedt, you always say that there's at least one kid in your class that gets some little break because they know a little bit about statistics. And they know a little bit more than other smart people. And you can help interpret and contextualize and say, well, what does this mean? Well, I'm going to tell you what it means. Boom, you're valuable. Instantly, you're valuable. And it doesn't take PhD level training and stuff to actually add value to organizations of professional people. It happens to me every single semester, I kid you not. And I'll even go further and say, this student, I don't think he liked the class all that much. I think he really liked what his internship got him. I think he really, really liked that. Good for him. So what's in it for you? So all scientists, political scientists, chemists, biologists, physicists, economists, we're involved in basically two kinds of things that are sort of related to each other. And in this textbook and in classes like this, you'll learn about both of these things. The first thing that we do is we try to generate new theories about the way the world works. A new theory. So that's a pretty high bar. Has to be something new. So we saw these great data about inequality, and you saw throughout the 90s there was that period of a spike where inequality got a little bit worse, and then it leveled off. And you can say to yourself, well, why did inequality go up when it did? And then why didn't it just keep going up, right? Why did that happen? And in order to sort of demonstrate something, bring something new to the conversation, you have to be aware of the previous explanations that are out there for the causal process that produces inequality, that increases it or decreases it. And you have to be able to say, well, I have a different idea about something that might have caused this shift to have happened. And so you have to have something new to say. Otherwise, you're testing somebody else's idea, or you're testing something that we already think we know the answer to. So that's really hard, by the way. And then the rest of what we do is, once we have a theoretical idea, we test these ideas against the best data we can find. And so in this class, you'll learn something about, well, where do theories come from? Where is this sort of first idea of how do you generate a new theoretical idea? It's not super easy. And in fact, it's not just kind of like, oh, we show up in my office and, you know, but halfway through that first cup of coffee, yeah, then we'll start thinking about it. No, it's harder than that. It is for me, at least. I guess I should just, maybe for these illustrious people, this is just super simple. But no, for me, it's pretty hard. But this second part, once you have a theoretical idea, whether it's yours or you're trying to adjudicate perhaps between two different competing theories, you're going to say, well, how do we do that? How do we judge which one is more likely to be true? Well, there are essential thinking skills about designing and setting up research for how to make really good comparisons. And then related to that, there are some statistical tools that you'll learn that help make those sorts of assessments in a rigorous way, in a scientific way, most likely, in most circumstances, in a quantitative way, but certainly in a scientific way. In our view, the thinking skills about how do we set this up and the statistical skills, like how do I crunch the numbers, they should never be separated from each other, ever. So why is requiring methods and statistics good for you? That's why they're making you take this class. Why is it good for you? So here's an example. We had motivation earlier with inequality. Now we'll motivate by talking about very well-known austerity policies that were common but not universally applied across Europe in the wake of the Great Recession. Well, do austerity programs work? Do slashing budgets, does that work, right? Does this help? Now, mind you, you're not allowed to answer by referring to your ideology or any other metaphysical source. You know, so you could be a good partisan of the left or a good partisan of the right and say, you know, the people on the left have said, no, of course, these programs cause more problems than they solve, blah, 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 blah. And the people on the right say, of course they're helpful. They prevent runaway inflation and all of these sorts of things. And when you watch BBC or, certainly the programs in America, when we instead of talking calmly to each other, you know, sort of shout at each other and storm off the set and all this, it's unwatchable. You're not allowed to answer these questions this way. You can't already say, well, I already know the answer because I'm a good leftist or I'm a good person on the right, and so, you know, you know the answer. No, that's not a scientific answer. That's an ideological answer. And so it's not an admissible source of knowledge to refer to ideology, metaphysics, or whatever, right? Those may be sources of knowledge for other things, but not for science, okay? So how do we know the answer? Well, how does a scientist try and figure out the answer to stuff like this? The first thing we might say is, well, what do we mean by a policy working? Let's specify a particular sort of outcome, and we could specify maybe even a list of outcomes. That's perfectly useful, like what happens with growth rates or something like that. Next, and this is perhaps the key insight, let's realize that the outcome that we're talking about, that we care the most about, is probably caused by several factors. Almost every single thing that we're interested in, whether it's inequality or, you know, sort of growth rates in the economy or policy preferences, like I study public opinion, policy preferences, almost all of these things are caused by many causes, not just one. And if we're going to make a correct assessment of the impact of the thing we care about, we have to somehow figure out a way to, what I'll just say, control for those other effects. And that's kind of vague sounding right there. Well, you're going to learn how to control for them with some thinking skills in the first part of our book and with some associated statistical skills in the second part of the book. And only once you say, well, what are the other causes of these outcomes, or what are the other causes of inequality, can I understand whether the policy had a particular impact, right? So if in the absence of doing that, you are likely to have a kind of a literally biased answer to a question like that. So I think that thinking skills like this are very much like muscles, cognitive muscles, brain muscles. And the thing is, almost everybody in here, certainly the case for me, I got interested in political science not because, like, oh, I really like statistics, I'm really good at math, I'm just into, you know, I want to do applied math for the rest of my life and just kind of go around and solve problems like that. Though I do know people like that. It's cool. If that's the way you're wired up, that's cool. But the huge majority of us that are interested, that are actual researchers, got into this because we care about the substance of things. Like I said, I study public opinion. I really care about why people want what they want from government or why they don't want things from government and why that varies over time. And to me, that's just like, I haven't stopped being fascinated in it for 18 years, and I don't see why I'm going to stop in the near future. In order to answer any of these particular questions, what I discovered is I actually needed to learn some research skills, including some statistical skills. And I do think that these are the kinds of things that take work. Much in the same way, if you're starting an exercise regimen or something similar, you sometimes just need to start with some baby steps and keep at it. Sometimes at the beginning it's hard. Sometimes, and for some of you, you'll take to it like a duck takes to water, and good for you if that's the way it happens to be with you. But like a muscle, the more you practice, the more you solve problems, the better you'll get at it. And the last thing is this whole idea, if any, don't raise your hand, please. I don't want you to self-identify. But think to yourself, have any of you ever said to yourself, I'm not a math person. I'm not a math person. That's something that you can overcome in classes like this. You don't have to be a math person to do well in things like this. You do have to be willing to work hard. I assume that all of you are perfectly happy to work hard. And if you are, and just have the basics of secondary school algebra, and maybe even your secondary school algebra is a little rusty, that's okay. We'll walk you through that and shake off some of that rust too. You'll do just great. And so you don't have to be some person who does real analysis or whatever to be able to get this. So that's where I'll stop, and I certainly look forward to hearing some of your interests and concerns as well. So thanks for your time.
Just to add to Catherine's presentation, so on top of me doing text analytics, I'm also involved in UCL QSTEP. As you know, there's 15 centers around UK that are funded by Nuffield, DSRC, Hefke. So Lucas will be talking later. We're both from UCL QSTEP. And I'll be talking about career opportunities specifically in data science. This is something that text analytics is part of and something that you will be doing also in one way or another. So Catherine mentioned that about the sexiest job of the 21st century. There was an article in Harvard Business Review in 2012 that was the title of the article. The sexiest job of the 21st century is a data scientist. And I'll talk later what it means to be a data scientist, at least how we understand it. But that just to show you that, just to underline Catherine's point, that was a statistician, there was a banker before. Now it may be something that you can be. You can actually be one of those sexy people of the 21st century, right? And this is something that we all talk about. It's the data-driven discovery and decision-making. And as Gary King said, you probably have not encountered yet, but I'm sure that Catherine will make you read a lot of articles by Gary King. Gary said that it's a revolution. It's a revolution that is in the making. And this was some time ago, so a lot of things changed since that. So in this longish quote, the march of quantification made possible by enormous new sources of data will sweep through academia, business, and government. There's no area that is going to be untouched. So how many of you have heard about big data? Those who have not heard about, are you using Gmail, Facebook? So this is essentially what is there. All the data that you produce every day, this data is now out there and it can be analyzed. And it can be analyzed to make decisions, help companies make decisions, help governments make decisions. And I'll give you a couple examples in a sec. Right. So I think one of the things you care about is getting a job afterwards. And this was a report by McKinsey, one of the biggest consulting companies in the world. And their reports say that there's a shortage in the United States, this is specifically about the United States, but there's a shortage of about 140,000 to 190,000 people with analytical expertise. And by that, they mean people who actually can do data science in terms of computer science involved with everything else. And I'll mention this in a sec. But then look at this, there's 1.5 million managers and analysts who actually know what the other guys are talking about. So you have to have some knowledge of stats, you have to know some computer science, you have to have some idea about the data analytics, but maybe not be a programmer or computer scientist yourself. And there's actually more jobs like that. So these are the shortages that are currently in the US economy. And we have no reports about the UK economy. Probably the numbers would be similar on relative scale. So this is just an example. One of the biggest websites for job searches in the US, where you post a job, indeed.com. And you can actually do a search for a term that you're looking for and see what was the job ads that came in. So this is the search on indeed.com for data science, right? And you can see this tremendous growth rate over the last several years. The number of jobs that are being advertised in the US, it is growing almost exponentially with a brief interlude here. So there's a demand for these jobs, and there's an increasing demand for these jobs in the data science. So now I'll mention what we think is data science and how it's relevant for you. So at least that's how we think about it, is using this Drew Conway's Venn diagram. So you have math and statistics knowledge, and this is something that you will be doing in your course. You also have substantive expertise. These are all the other courses that you will be doing as part of your PPE. And this is anything. So if you take a course in a substantive area, that adds to your substantive expertise, right? And then is the hacking skills, so some computer science skills. It's the intersection of all of these three areas that creates what some people consider to be a data scientist. So it's not a computer scientist per se, it's not a statistician per se, it's a person who combines the skills that has the computer science, data analytics skills, substantive expertise, and some of the computer science, so some of the programming skills that you can pick up, right? Statistical software skills. So this is how we understand the data science and how a lot of people understand the data science. And I'll just give you a couple examples of what we think and some of the things. So at UCL, we also have a big data center. So this is an ESSC-funded big data center, consumer data research center. We try to analyze, we have a lot of data and we try to analyze and help people, help companies make decisions. But we also help local councils make decisions. So just to give you an example, EasyJet. EasyJet produces millions and millions of passengers take EasyJet flights every year, and they try to optimize how many through flights you take, how many connecting flights you make. And based on that, that can inform their decisions about optimizing the number of airplanes they need to keep in reserve if something breaks down. Companies, simple retails. So a lot of you, when you shop, you leave behind a data trail, so some fingerprint of you left in the system. If you scan your points card in Marks & Spencer, Waitrose, that leaves some data behind. Companies can analyze this data and really interested to analyze this data. So we work with retailers to analyze the data and help them make decisions about the optimizing their decision making in the company, right? British Gas, so the consumers who work, consumers, and when do you actually supply gas to the companies? Is there anything you can optimize in your business procedures to help them? But it's also government that makes decisions based on data. So the evidence-based policy making. So we work with local councils and we try to supply data about, you have retail outlets and then some of them may close down. So we want to analyze why they closed down. Is it because of a crime rate going up? Is it because of something else? So all this data is there, you analyze it and you can help companies, local authorities and government make decisions. So at UCL, the way we approach it is we're trying to combine the several things together. So it's the substantive courses. Again, it's the substantive expertise. So it's the PPE, population health, human geography, and applied social science. These are the degrees that we have, and students take substantive courses. Then it's the sequence of quantitative methods courses. So it starts with introduction, then it's more advanced courses, and then it's highly advanced in the final year courses with some introduction of the big data in the second year. And then we introduce the big data and the insights. The key is, what kind of decisions can you make based on data? So it's the insights from data. Just knowing the hacking skills and the statistical skills is not enough. It's translating this into the decision making that is quite often really the hardest part. So it's insights from data analytics. And also trying to make this, because we live in a connected world, right? So it's also the network science. And then we plan also to have a course that is specifically a 10-week full-term course on big data. So these are the things we're doing, and we're doing this specifically for that, because we think that it's the intersection of all the skills. None of these areas by itself is not going to be enough. And again, why we're doing this is that there are lots of jobs out there, and lots of jobs that you can take.
Yeah. Great, thank you so much.
So thanks very much for, I think, three different but very important contributions or interventions that hopefully you can now respond to. First, why would we care at all about numbers, about data? Because there's societal problems that are really important and actually very difficult to fully grasp. And even with data, they're difficult to grasp, as Andrew Dilnot outlined, but it's cool and it's fun, and that's what we would want to do. Then Paul Kellstedt went on to talk about how would we do that within a course? Why do we do that? We do that to get a sense, a handle on practical problems, but also to try to understand research that we're reading in our so-called substantive parts of our course. And then thirdly, and that was the kind of career part, is what Slava was talking about how important data has become, and especially also big data has become. And that it's important to think about not only what you want to do in terms of study, but also what you could perhaps learn for your career after. I think for me it was also amazing because this kind of Q-step idea, which is there for you and hopefully you can utilize and get all these techniques, started about a year ago in a very small room just there. And now to sit here and to actually be able to offer you the course, even though you feel that you're forced to, as Paul said, but to you know, give you the possibility to learn more, I think is really exciting. And I want to thank the Nuffield Foundation and Hefke and IRSAC for providing us the funding to do so. And we do that together with, for example, also the UCL Q-step Center. So we've been talking a lot, and now I wanted to give the kind of the floor to you. Are there any questions? And I'm going to walk around. Hopefully it's on. Yes, it's on. I'm going to walk around with a microphone. And then the panelists, if they want, they can sit up front. If they don't want, they can sit where they want. But do whatever you feel like. Yeah. OK, are there questions? Yes. Just please say your name and then to whom you're
referring. Sorry, I don't have much voice today. my name is Johanna. Maybe that's a German thing to be a little bit paranoid about data security, but you listed all the courses that we could have. What if I don't want my data to be analyzed? What if I don't even want my data to be collected? Can we have courses on that as well?
Very good question. Slava, do you want to take it? Or?
I'm just happy to say that there are all these courses that allow you to, that develop the skills for you to analyze the data. And if you specifically don't want your data to be analyzed, I don't think there's a course specifically on that, but there's a course on data security that you can take.
With my Oxford hat on, but with my chairman of the UK Statistics Authority hat, something that certainly national statistics institutes around the world are taking very seriously. And my own sense about this is it's much more about private sector data than public sector data. So the kinds of organizations that Slava just mentioned know a great deal about all of us, those of us who ever buy anything from Amazon or use Google, who go to the supermarket. There's a great deal of actually, in many ways, very personal data collected there. And for what it's worth, my own sense is that much of the, and perhaps I would, this is the kind of Mandy Rice Davis response from me, I would say this, wouldn't I? But by and large, the use of data collected by the public sector is pretty well controlled. I mean, there are occasions when it can go wrong, and it's very, very important that we all take getting that right very seriously, and that means changing the way we do things. But by and large, for example, in the area of health data, which is being much discussed in the UK at the moment, the upsides for the population as a whole, from appropriately anonymized and with very careful privacy safeguards, data being available are very, very great. It's also often the case that it is possible to try and find ways to allow individuals to opt out of data, of their data being used if they want to. But I hope we won't move into that world, because I think if we do, then if we move it into it in a very large way, then we risk major breakthroughs in medical understanding, for example, being missed because of that. But if we're not to go down that, we have to be much better than we have been so far at making people feel confident that their personal data is being treated anonymously and with respect and isn't vulnerable.
I just wanted to add that, just to assure that all the projects that I listed and I mentioned, there's great care, as Andrew was saying, it's great care about anonymizing data when we don't know the individuals. All of this is highly accurate, or it's anonymized in a way that there's specific procedures in place in UK, at least, that area that I know, where you wouldn't be able to identify an individual person. It's really difficult. It's extremely difficult, almost impossible to identify even an area where an individual person can live towards the house. So the closest we can get with a post index, right? That's the closest you can get, and it's still quite difficult. So anonymization and privacy, these are the key concerns, and all the funding authorities, this is one of the conditions when they fund, that it has to be it's private data, and so privacy and anonymization, it has to be in place.
I think what's just my two cents to that as well, and also hopefully some of the teachers who want to respond to that as well. I think ethics and the ethics of research and how you do research. For example, if you do, let's say, a field experiment in Africa to try to understand how ethnic violence affects election outcomes. So there's quite a big discussion now within political science in general, but I presume in economics, about actually some of these people are affecting real election outcomes. Is that ethical? Can you do that as a researcher? Other thing, maybe you've heard of a social psychologist called Stapel in the Netherlands who actually faked his data, right? So there's quite a big discussion about the ethics of data, not just when I'm responding to it, not just in big data, but actually much broader. And hopefully within the program, and I see people nodding, hopefully within the program, we're gonna at least try to tell you how to go about doing that in terms of data collection and what you should be looking out for in journal articles. And you'll be surprised how often certain projects haven't gone through what's called ethical review, i.e. a review board at a university saying this is okay, and there's specialists doing that. So it's a very good question, not just in big data, but in data collection in general. Anybody wants to add? I'm going to go to you first.
My name's Leo. I just wanted to follow up on that question from you to ask specifically about the development of technology, especially technology that's able to crunch this type of data. And I was just wondering whether, as that technology becomes more and more advanced, you know, we are less about 30 years into the technological revolution, you know, 100 years from now, I'm interested to hear your perspectives on whether we're going to be in a position where technology is going to be available that will make that level of data security that you say is around now virtually impossible, especially in this world of hacking and data leaks and so on.
Anyone cares to take that question?
I mean, I think my view on that is we have no idea what the world, we simply have no idea what the world will look like in 100 years' time. My answer is, I don't know. I think we can try. And actually, there's been a huge amount of information available for quite a long time. The growing awareness that it's available ought to help us manage it. But there are risks. Of course, there are risks.
I just wanted to add that the amount of security built into data now is not the same as 4 years ago. So we are catching up. So this is a reaction to also the technology advancing. So hopefully, again, we don't know what's going to happen in 100 years' time, but we would assume that something will be in place. At least that's our hope, right? But we don't know.
Can you say your name as well and then your question?
Hi, my name is Paul. The Kellstedt course is only at 15 universities, and it's a good step that people get to, everyone gets to have a chance with statistics. Currently, for previous years, there are only 3 people enlisted in quantitative methods courses for politics at the undergraduate level. How do you think we can, or the course can be altered, and the perception of statistics can be altered so that more people voluntarily take it up across the UK?
There were 3? I'm surprised there were that many.
It's an optional course, exactly, in the third year. Paul, do you want to take the question?
Yeah, no, I was going to say I'm shocked there were that many. I understand. Like I said at the beginning, this is your broccoli, right? Eat your broccoli. We believe that this is good for you as a person with career prospects. We believe that it's good for your engagement with classes. And without being, you know, too weighty about it, I actually do think that it's good for the country where you live. It's good for democracy to have citizens who are engaged and able to refute arguments, and scientific literacy is a good thing. I think that we can speculate about why, or, well, what are those 3 people who took this class like, it's better to get started on this now than it is to wait even more.
And the only other thing I'd add is I think, experiment. So it was an optional course. It turns out, I'm at a college where I think without exception, the graduates coming and wanting to do graduate politics, graduate sociology, graduate economics in this university all are excited by and want to do this stuff. So as you go further, that comes on. But people don't realise what fun it is. I mean, they just don't realise what fun it is. And to our great shame in the UK, we live in a country where the culture is somewhat anti-scientific and very anti-mathematical in a peculiar Luddite, sad way, where, you know, we live in a country where it was acceptable when one of our, in many ways, most gifted chancellors of the Exchequer, treasurer, finance minister, about 8 or 9 years ago could say, as a way of trying to look cool and curry favour, "Oh, I'm not very good at numbers," on a radio programme, said, "I'm not very good at numbers." And it was bad in so many ways, not least that it wasn't true, actually. He was actually a highly numerate person, but he said it was all right to say he wasn't good at it. That was a way of making himself look cool, and we have to break out of that whole world. And that's partly why the Q-Step initiative is happening. It's why the Nuffield Foundation, FKE, ESRC have done this, to try to nudge the system into getting good-looking, intelligent young people like you realising what fun it is and being the best evangelists.
That's your job.
I just wanted to say one thing, that it's interesting that on the graduate level, it's only, let's say, 3 people or whatever the number might be. Once you get to the master's level, you would be surprised how many people actually want to take a quantitative methods course at the master's level, because that's when you realize that the 3 years in the undergraduate and you face the job prospects, and that's what helps you to get a job, right? So I think part of the Q-Step initiative is try to push it so the decision is done a bit earlier, that this is actually useful. It's extremely useful for you.
So, I mean, now we're going to go from 3 in political science to 280, because all our first-year graduates are going to do this. But I think what's very important is the way that we try to do with it, and people correct me if I'm wrong on this, is try to kind of say, well, often it's a bimodal distribution. You have the lovers and you have the haters. And the haters are strong haters. And to admit, I was a hater when I went into university. In the Netherlands, you get about 4 courses in statistics only. There's no qualitative methods, nothing at all. And at a certain point, I thought, oh, I'm winning arguments in a better way when I actually back it up, rather than trying to argue my way through it. So I got more and more and more involved in it, was interested. So I actually went from the haters to maybe lovers later on, right? What we try to do is kind of speak to both of that and say, well, what are substantive things that you're interested in? So there's a reason why you study PPE, and often the reason you study PPE is because you have a sense of, you know, public policy that you might be interested in, history and politics. You want to understand politics in the UK or maybe in other places. Let's start with those first and then go into the numbers. So start from inequality and then try to, how do we measure inequality? So hopefully, what our aim is that the elective in the third year is going to go from 3 to 10 people. So, you know, we're not kind of going into the large numbers, but that we're going to at least have a couple of, you know, a couple of people more. And I think you guys also, in that way, are a little bit the guinea pigs, and maybe also a bit the ambassadors, if you like it. And next year, hopefully, we're going to do an event, and we're going to do what's so-called self-selection. We're only going to get those of you who really like it to speak here. To kind of sell the program a little bit, right? And that's what we're trying to do here. But, you know, be critical. I'd rather have that some of you say, well, Catherine, I don't think we can quantify democratization research. I don't think I can study democracy using numbers. But you have to tell me why that's the case. And you have to come up with things like internal validity or something like that, or you know, some kind of story why that's the case, rather than saying, I just don't like numbers. I don't like them, or I like them. I want you to be informed about it. And I think all of us want to do that. So hopefully, that's what we're going to be able to achieve. I have 3. I'm just going to go, or 4. I'm just going to go through, and then we collect a couple and reflect on that. Is that OK? Go ahead. Say your name and the question.
Thank you. My name's Will. And I'm just wondering about the subjectivity of collecting and analyzing data. Isn't it the case that however you apply yourself, you're always looking at it through one particular paradigm, the data, and therefore it will always be subjective, and therefore won't data inevitably be used just to reinforce the ideological perspective that you come from, and essentially, be ineffective, you know.
Yep.
So the answer to your question is absolutely, whatever form of data it is. including the dominant form of data, which is not quantitative data. The dominant form of data in social science is language. Non-quantitative data is at least as subject to the subjectivity that you're worried about as quantitative data. So yes, it's a concern whenever we're studying anything that, of course, our subjective views will have an effect on it. It's a concern when we're looking at using it quantitative data. It's a concern with all old-fashioned methods as well. And it's something that certainly when you're doing quantitative analysis, you should be aware of. But quantitative analysis is no more subject to it than any other form of analysis. Although the point that you raised is often thought about when you look at quantitative analysis and not thought about when you look at all the other forms of analysis.
It's frustrating to see people come to drastically different conclusions from the same set of data. So coming from the US, for example, I would hear the Obama campaign say, okay, look, unemployment is down by a certain percentage point, and that's great. And then the Republicans would say, oh, look, this number of people actually dropped out of the workforce. And the same thing could be said about minimum wage or income inequality, wealth inequality. So I'm just wondering if data scientists are still, at the end of the day, to some extent, at the mercy of politicians or people who talk, or I mean, even worse, TV pundits who try to make sense of the data for the public, and whether you know the data scientists themselves might be objective, or as much as they try, very objective when taking these data or measuring them. But at the end of the day, even accurate data could be manipulated. Or interpreted in so many different ways.
Well, since I live in America and I know the channels that you're talking about, I'm happy to comment on them. The first thing is that most people who are scientists don't really care what people on Fox News or MSNBC say. I really don't care because they have a job, right? Their job is to sell commercials, and they're really good at it. And for people who have a taste for arguing about politics, as opposed to watching sports or reality television, the people who have a taste for politics get to watch Fox or MSNBC or something like that, and it's for entertainment, and that's great. Their job is to sell commercials, not to tell the truth, right? And they're really good at selling commercials. So most scientists that I know don't pay very much attention to what happens on Fox News or MSNBC, and they don't really care because they understand that they're not trying to tell the truth. They're just peddling whatever they think they can peddle to sell commercials. It's capitalism, and it's fine. I guess the other thing that I would say is that when you used a perfect example actually about MSNBC says unemployment's going down, and Fox News says but look at all the people who dropped out of the labor force. It's like they say this 18 times a day on these networks, right? And it's a bit tiresome. But the thing is that neither one of those networks is comfortable with any kind of ambiguity, but reality happens to be kind of ambiguous. The economy is a relatively relatively complicated thing. Yes, unemployment has been shrinking. Yes, a lot of people are dropping out of the labor force. Yes, stock prices are at an all-time high. ExxonMobil is making record profits. Is the economy doing great or is it crap? Well, I mean, if you're on Fox News, the economy's crap. It's all crap, and it's ironic to hear them complain about the poor people and their unemployment. For the people on the right to do that is rich, right? It's really rich. And then, of course, you turn on to MSNBC and you see them trumpeting corporate profits are at an all-time high. Oh God! And like, yeah, so people on the left are cheering corporate profits. And I think that they unmask themselves just perfectly fine. They don't care about the complexity of reality. They're cheerleaders for a particular point of view, and that's okay. But they have no interest in complexity, and the problem is the world's kind of complicated.
I think that's absolutely right, and the wonderful thing about statistical thinking is it forces you to be precise. Mm-hmm. And it forces you, when faced with two apparently conflicting statements, to try and work out whether one of them is false or whether they're both true, and there's another more interesting way of reflecting on it. The point Paul makes about complexity is central. All of the things that all of you are studying are complex, and statistics are one of your statistical Database analysis is one of your chances of actually getting to grips with what's going on.
And just to finish, sorry, Andy, complexity makes for really bad television. it just does. So,
I just wanted to weigh in on this a little bit too. I'm, as I said before, Andy Eggers, I'll be teaching some lectures in January in the second term. So one way to think about this is, as Paul said, we do our scientific research, and the public comments it on ways that reflect their interests. And I think Paul's being kind of flip in saying we don't care about it. Because in a way, of course, I think in Paul's own work and other people's work, we care about it as scientists. We're interested in the process of how evidence is used by the public and how media representations affect what happens in policy and opinion. And I just wanted to share an example from this weekend. I was at a conference where I saw a new very clever paper that I think is an instance of using these methods to analyze the process by which opinions are formed, by which this very partisan media affects the outcomes. And the idea of the paper was, so as Paul said, people watch this stuff for entertainment. So how would you ever know if this very partisan media affects what people believe, since all the lefties are all watching the left-oriented channel and all the right-wingers are watching the right-wing channel? It's very hard to disentangle the correlation from the causation, in other words. So the idea of this paper was that in cable lineups in different parts of the US, the channels appear at different points. And the paper shows that when the channel is closer to channel one, people will watch it slightly more, independent of the preferences. So in places where Fox News is like at channel 10 instead of channel 30, people watch it like 10 minutes more per average, on average. And so they use this variation in where the channel is located on the dial to show not just an effect on what people watch, but also on their like intentions to vote and their opinions. So, okay, that's like extremely depressing on both counts, right? Like where the channel is located affects what people watch, and what people watch affects how they vote. It's very depressing. It's the sort of thing that we should know when it's happening. We want to understand what's going on. It does inform policy, because there is a debate about the extent to which media should be regulated, the extent to which media should be, there should be provision of a healthy public source for news that has certain constraints about how biased it is. So, just to sum up, I think you can think of your work as a data scientist as trying to bring more science to debates that happen, try to make Fox News and MSNBC and the Telegraph and whoever else accountable for what they say. You can also think about it as you're sort of analyzing that process and being trying to understand that process by which people's opinions are formed and understand how partisanship affects what people think. That's a very important area of very active research, and I think it's something you'll be reading articles about.
Great, thank you, Andy, very much for that. So the last question, I know some of you may still have questions. There's tea, we're breaking out for tea, and then you can go wherever you want, but you have the possibility that all the panelists and the teachers will be there at tea, so you can ask the question if you want. And now the last question, so last but not least, just say your name and the question.
My name's Dilnot, and I just wanted to ask, a lot of you spoke about how the data could be used to sort of influence policy decisions. Do any of you think there's sort of a danger for democracy if politicians start listening to data more than they do to real people?
No. Data is just a reflection of real people. If you want to know, much of our political debate includes things like senior politicians in all of our major parties referring to what this will mean for Middle Britain. And then they say, Middle Britain, you know, a teacher married to a doctor. A teacher married to a doctor on my income distribution chart is here. Okay, so is that good or is it bad? It's appallingly terrible. You know, we've got representations of Middle Britain that are actually way out in the top 1/3 of 1% of the income distribution. So is talking to real people, getting that kind of impression from the media, a good thing or a bad thing? Well, it seems to me it's an unambiguously bad thing because it's not a fair representation of reality. So of course you can't substitute dry data for real engagement with people's real lives, but by and large what politicians mean when they say real people is just a complete misrepresentation of underlying reality. Now you need these two things to go together. So one of the things that I really hope you'll be doing in your courses is looking at qualitative as well as quantitative research methods. And that can be extraordinarily important. So when motivating a piece of quantitative research, it's often really important to have some qualitative research that underlies it. So if for example, you're interested in the impact of tax and social security policies on labour market decisions of single parents, you should go out and talk to some single parents to try to understand what might be the things that determine whether a single father or mother enters the labour market, so that you can then frame your data-based analysis of that in the lived experiences of real people. But if you haven't got data alongside it, then you might well go and talk to some people who are completely unrepresentative of the population you're looking at. So there's no tension between genuine engagement in the lives of real people and data. They're actually all part of the same process. And if you try to look at real people without data, you're risking getting it horribly, horribly wrong. And that is, I think, by and large, what our political debate does. Sorry to be so.
Thank you very much, Andrew.
Exactly. I couldn't agree more. I mean, I think when you say like, what's the counterfactual of saying, well, if policymakers listen to science and data, as opposed to real people, but you know, the evidence that we have about who policymakers listen to currently doesn't suggest that we have an over reliance on science and objective evidence. That strikes me as a non-problem.
Thank you very much to the panelists, to Andrew Dilnot, Slava Mikhaylov, and Paul Kellstedt. Give them a round of applause. And then I think the second but the biggest thank you goes to all of you for being here today. This was voluntary, so I'm really, really happy that so many of you are there. I also want you to keep those critical hats on. We know that of PPE, SNH, Paul, students, that they're critical, and we're gonna engage with you on that. But I think what's really important, the message we try to convey today is that you can argue points through polemic. Really nice. I love to do that in the pub. But what we love to do also is to argue points scientifically. And if we do that scientifically, data, either qualitative or quantitative, and here we're focusing a little bit more on quantitative and what you will be teaching you, is one part of that. And hopefully you'll share some of our enthusiasm, even though Paul said it might be hard at times, but we're there really to support you to get through that. And also in economics, if you do PPE, you'll get some of that as well. We're really looking forward, I think I'm speaking on behalf of all the Q-Step staff, we're really looking forward to seeing you guys in Hillary. Most of you I will see actually next week because I also teach you on the substantive part. But we're really looking forward to seeing you there, and hopefully you get a chance to read Paul's book and the other stuff that's on the material. Everything is online and on WebLearn. Thank you very much for coming, and we'll go off to tea for about half an hour. Then it's a tutor sessions for people who are involved in that, and you get the chance to answer questions because I saw there were more questions. Ask your questions to people of the panel and your professors in the break. Thanks very much for coming.